ADHD is definitely on the rise. Rates are increasing in both children and adults. And there is definitely more awareness out there for it. And we're doing a better job of identifying it. So the cardinal symptoms of ADHD are inattention, so trouble focusing, paying attention, hyperactivity, so moving around a lot, being really restless, and impulsivity, so doing things without thinking, like blurting out answers and interrupting, things like that. Many people experience ADHD symptoms. Many of us have trouble with paying attention, hyperactivity, being impulsive, but really it's how severe these symptoms are, how much more relative to people our age, and whether or not they're causing clinical impairment. So is it disrupting aspects of our lives? And the symptoms should be present across multiple settings. So not just in the home, but at school and in other settings. ADHD tends to be a lifelong disorder, but symptoms do tend to change over time. So as children with ADHD get older, their inattention symptoms tend to remain, but we see the hyperactivity tend to decrease or improve. The usual typical presentation of what we think of ADHD is a child who moves around a lot of hyperactivity. But what we're finding with girls with ADHD is that they tend to present with more of the inattentive subtype, and they tend to get overlooked. So now there's been more increased awareness of what ADHD looks like in girls, but we've definitely improved in our assessment of that. So the typical place to start is with a primary care physician, their pediatrician. So the pediatrician could give you rating scales, give parents rating scales to fill out, and other informants like their teachers or other care providers. And then they would go through like an interview. And then they could also refer out to specialists like a psychologist or a psychiatrist if necessary. But usually the primary care provider is usually the first step. So the parents should be prepared to do a developmental interview, report on the child's behavior, how long symptoms have been present, where it's present, what things make it worse, make it better, and also filling out rating scales to determine like the severity, intensity of their symptoms. Evidence-based treatment generally falls into two different categories. One being medication, stimulant and non-stimulant, and then behavioral therapy. So this usually involves like parent training and things like that. For younger children below the age of 6, AAP, the American Academy of Pediatrics, recommends behavior interventions before starting medications. But for older children, it tends to be a combination of medication with behavioral interventions. Parent training involves improving parent-child interactions and also behavior management, so increasing rewards for positive behaviors and ignoring or extinguishing undesirable and our unwanted behaviors. There are a lot of things that can improve ADHD symptoms, like exercise has been one that's been shown to improve symptoms. Sleep hygiene is a big one. If you're sleepy, it's really hard to pay attention. Diet's another one, but also there could be behavioral interventions within the school system, so school accommodations. And one big one is allowing for movement to occur. And what we're showing with a lot of the research is that movement might actually be helpful for kids with ADHD. So to tell a kid with ADHD, make sure you sit down, don't move, could be harmful. And so we're trying to study that to see what are the effects of fidgeting in our lab as well. But all these things don't cure ADHD, and if you don't have these lifestyle changes, it doesn't cause ADHD, but it could definitely help. Yes, ADHD is highly heritable. Studies are showing like heritability rates range from like 60 to 90%. And so what that means is if you are a parent with ADHD, you're more likely to have a child with ADHD as well. But it's not 100%, and there are other factors that is currently being conducted in research to figure out what other things cause ADHD. There's a lot of risk factors if it goes undiagnosed, like difficulties with school, so there's higher rates of school dropout, school retention, occupational difficulties, higher rates of other psychopathology like anxiety, depression, substance use, and things like that. But there are a lot of people with ADHD who do succeed in life, who are able to have all the things that they want and achieve many great things and have happy lives, but treatment and identification is really critical to that.